start? Are we going to go on yet? Okay, we're going to go on yet.
No, they close the door.
I understand. There's necks right on the ground that I have to stand up. So I will stand like this and talk.
Perfect. Don't move.
Don't move. Okay, I won't move. I will talk. This is, let's see, this is the 15th time I've done this class. So I might be a little punchy by the weekend, but we're talking about MyHeritage. In the first part of the classes, I showed a video. Some of you came earlier or saw it before. I decided the video took up too much time. We need to get more into the program. So basically, we're going to talk a little bit about the program. But before we get right to the program, there's a couple of things we need to talk about as far as registering and getting into this program. If you have the opportunity to have an LDS account, which means that you get free access to MyHeritage, Find My Past, and Ancestry.com. One of the things that we're finding very frequently in a very high percentage of the people is that they don't complete the registration. They think they are, they're there, and then they go type things in and it says, we need $7.50, or we need $6, or we need £5, or whatever they're asking for. The programs, that means basically that you haven't got the complete program. I will show you when we get into the MyHeritage program what it should look like on MyHeritage if you were going to be completely signed in. Basically, all you have to do is go back through the process, go to the link to get the buttons to sign in again, but make sure when you're signing in that you check all the little tiny boxes that are down in the corners underneath where you're clicking. Because there's a bunch of little check boxes. They're not obvious, but if you don't have them all checked, then that won't log you into the program properly. And if you have any trouble, or if you're already can't figure out why the program is working, then I'll be here till this afternoon when we have our afternoon class at 1 o'clock, and then I'll be here after that class until whenever we need to be to help you get onto the program. And then if you have any questions also, I'll be here to help individually. So it's just, you know, if you're all in there in the lab, in the library, then I will get to everybody as fast as I can. So when you're through, when you've got your login, the other key to this, of course, is you need to be logged in to FamilySearch.org before you start that process, because it'll have you do it anyway. But what we found is that there's some people that have forgotten their login and password to FamilySearch.org, so they may have to go through that process before they get into the MyHeritage and Ancestry and the other programs. But once you're here, then you need to use your login that you've created for MyHeritage, the password that you've created for MyHeritage. So while you're in this process, have a pen, paper, and pencil handy, and write down these whatever you type in. You might think, oh, I'll remember that. If you're like me, 2 days from now, you'd probably forget that you ever had that login or password. So make sure that you record those. Okay, now I'm going to log in over here. I understand I'll be off screen, but we'll let you see how it works. Now, they're working off an email address, and if you, on all these programs, and so if you have ever signed into this program before, with that email address, and it helps if you know how to spell and do things like that. That's always useful in this job. If you've ever been on the programs before, it's going to consider that you have an account. So they keep the accounts, I guess, as long as they're in business. And so you may find out that you tried to sign in to the program, you put in the email address and it comes back and said you're already a member or you've already been a member. In that case, you're going to have to remember the password that you used when you logged into the program the first time. That may not even be possible. So what you're going to, then at that point you will have to restore your password, which involves accessing your email account. Most of the people lately have been able to get into their email account from the computers here in the library. Some people can't. In that case, you're going to have to wait till you get home, pick it up, log in.
If you use your email as your entry, then can you just use, like, I changed my email account is it my current one or is it the one I
gave? It's not your email password that you're using. You have a different password for MyHeritage.
So they want my email name,
right?
And then they want
their password.
Thank you.
Okay, that's, I hope that's clear. Okay, so now if I log in, if I can remember my password, that'll be helpful. Oh, okay. How about that? There we go. Helps when you know how to type too. I don't want to be kept plugged in. And there we go. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the program and what you're actually looking at when you start into working with MyHeritage. MyHeritage is a, let's call it a vast program that extends all around the world. There are probably members in almost any country that has that anyone has a computer and access to the internet. They've got somebody on MyHeritage. The movie that I was showing previously talks about the involvement that the CEO Gilad Jaffe has with the program. He uses the program in the movie to find and restore paintings to people who had them, or the heirs of the people who had them confiscated by the Nazis during World War II. And it's a very interesting movie. It's on YouTube, and I might mention this about YouTube, that some of us think of YouTube when we are working with sort of annoying videos and all sorts of weird things. Well, one thing you should know is that every one of these organizations, of these genealogical organizations, have their own YouTube channel. And a channel means that they can put all their videos in one place on YouTube, so you can see everything that somebody's done. I have my own YouTube channel. The Family History Library, BYU Family History Library, has its own YouTube channel. Everybody's got a YouTube channel up there, and these videos that we're taking, like this one right now, will go up on that YouTube channel. So we already have the video that we had from the last few weeks on Ancestry has been up on there for a week or two now. So when you go if you look up any of the companies, you'll see that there's a little, down below it says Buy MyHeritage. Well, that's their YouTube channel. So if you click on that link, which is usually right under the title of the video, then it takes you to their channel, and if you click on the video, let's cut this guy off, and then if you click on the video link here, every video that they have will come up in a big long list of videos. So that one that I had that talked about the activities of the CEO is right up there in the corner, and then the rest of the instructional videos. So if you're having trouble with MyHeritage, you might want to spend a little bit of time clicking on some of these videos that will give you some instruction directly at home. And a good thing about it is, if you wake up in the middle of the night, you can't sleep, and you're worried about something, just go watch one of these videos. It'll put you right out. You won't have any trouble at all.
What's the best browser to use? Does it matter?
I don't know. I switch back and forth depending on if I have trouble with the browser.
Well, doesn't matter.
I'm using Chrome. I use Firefox, I use Safari, I use whatever I happen to have. I have almost all my computers, I use Apple computers, so Microsoft's Internet Explorer does not work on my computer, so they don't support Apple. So I don't use that one very often.
You're here.
Yeah.
Okay, so now you know where to find the stuff. Kind of to get an idea, one of the things I think is important about MyHeritage is that this program was developed by people who are very, very interested in genealogy or were genealogists or interested in their families. A lot of the people who are involved with MyHeritage use their own program, and they are very much involved in their families and talking about their ancestors. Some of the people that I've talked to are had contact with at MyHeritage actually went to work there because they were interested in genealogy. That's how they got there. That's a little bit in contrast to some of the other online websites, where the people who have been hired or who have run those companies are business people, and they don't necessarily have much contact with genealogy. So from that standpoint, this is an interesting program because it's built by genealogy people who are interested in genealogy for genealogists, and it works very well in that context. What I have found over the past couple of weeks as we've been working with all the missionaries and other patrons and everybody out there in the library and getting onto the program is, there's kind of two opposite poles. There are the people who just don't get any of it, which I really can't help a lot of times. But for the people who get down and start working with the program and get the program, there's usually just this absolute amazement at the amount of information that they're going to get from this program. It is amazing, the automatic searching of sources and contacts that this could generate. And I'll show you a little bit about how that works. So what we're going to, and by the way, before I even get over here to the computer, I'll keep bouncing back like a jack-in-the-box. But less nice, because that's how I was raised, eating a jack-in-the-box. So that's probably why I act like this. Okay. So the interesting thing about the program is that it's based on a social networking model. So the whole concept here is to be able to enable people who are using the program and who have their family trees online to contact each other about the common ancestors that they have. Now you can say, well, that works well in all the other programs. Everybody else has the same kind of sharing thing. The difference is the emphasis, because that is one of the core usage of the program. That's how it's set up. So everything you do will sort of lead you in that direction towards contacting other members of your family. And that's one of the reasons the program's grown so rapidly. But to give you some idea of what it is, we'll go down to the bottom of the page, all the way down, and all the way down to the bottom of that portion where it says member map. And this is the member map. It's a little program that shows you some things about MyHeritage. First of all, you're going to look over here in the corner and you're going to see 72,526,464, which is the current number of members of this particular program. 72.5 million people worldwide. Now, for example, if you were to compare that to the church has about 15 million members worldwide, and so this program has more than 3.5 times more members than the entire church. And also in countries all over the world that wouldn't dream of letting Mormons come into their community. So another thing that's interesting is, look at this. This screen across the bottom is a real-time stream. It's showing you people who are signing up for the program. And it goes day and night. Since I've been teaching this program, the number of people on the members on the program have increased by over 100,000 just in the last week. And so, it's pretty impressive. Another thing about it is you'll see the people coming up here. It'll be female in their 20s, male in their 20s. Then there's a few older people. More than I sort of recently we're seeing a few more older people, but in the past, what I've seen is everybody, most two-thirds, maybe more of the people coming on the program are under 30. Now, if you think about it, for example, Family Search has been emphasizing the fact that we need to involve the youth in genealogy and had all sorts of programs during the past year and a half. And now what we have here is a program that does that very successfully. We have young people all over the world getting onto a genealogy program that, by the way, supplies a lot of sources and contacts, and they're putting their family trees up online. So they're doing something right. You might think about this, that maybe this is one of the reasons, if not maybe even a principal reason, why Family Search would be interested in having a partnership with a company like this. maybe they're getting to people that Family Search has not been able to get to. So what we have is a very interesting program. Now, if I click on any one of those geographic areas up there, look at that. Okay, there's Europe. All these little flag guys are proportional in size to the number of people that they have online in those particular countries. So if you look at the map, you'll see that, Great Britain has 3.5 million, and they still have Scotland, so they can keep that. Probably have about the same number. And then they have Spain with over 1 million, Portugal with 300,000, Italy with over 1 million, Greece down here, 150,000, Romania, Moldova, Ukraine. I don't know if you want to go to Ukraine right now. 90,000, Belarus, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, up here to Finland. You can see that all of these Eastern European countries have it. Now let me suggest this. Let's suppose this is what the program does. If you put your family tree online, it will take that family tree and match everyone in the tree to everyone else of the 72.5 million people, and anytime there's a match, it will tell you that you have a common ancestor. Okay, so that's what it's doing. And then the second part of that is the program allows you right at that point to connect to those people directly. You can email them directly. You can send them a link through the program. Those things come about directly through the program. Now let's suppose that you had ancestors in one of those Eastern European countries, in Latvia or Lithuania or Romania or Belarus or someplace like that, or Czech Republic or any of the other places. This is not impossible, because I've worked with people just within the last couple of months, probably with dozens of people who have had Eastern European ancestry. And here's the question. Let's suppose that you've traced your ancestor back and you confirm that they came as an immigrant from Latvia or from Estonia. Where are you going to go to find genealogical records to research your family? Okay, well, you could go to one of those countries and try to find out where the records were, and try to gain access to the records. First of all, you probably don't speak the language, and you probably have no idea where they are or how to get to them. Okay, but you could. I mean, that's possible. You could research all that. Or you could put your family tree up on MyHeritage, and because of the numbers of people in these countries that are on this program, there's a very, very good chance that you'll run into someone who is a relative. And now what have you got? You've got a person there who is your relative, who speaks the language, who has access to the records or knows where they are, and is online doing genealogy. Okay, so now you can see that there's this great advantage. Now, it works like that in those Eastern European countries, but it also works every place else the same way. If you've traced your ancestry back and you found what you call a brick wall, you can't find any information, you may very well find someone in the program who has that same person. And so we'll talk about how that works and how you can get together with people and work on the program. Let's just go to the Middle Eastern, Asian, Eastern European countries. We've got Israel here with 300,000, Turkey with more than 1 million, Russia with more than 1 million, little countries like Yemen with 2,000, Oman, and you'll recognize that there are some of these countries that you probably would even have difficulty gaining access to, much less getting in there to do genealogical research. But because there are people in that country online in this program, you then have the opportunity, at least a potential, of connecting with people who share your ancestry if you're from one of those places. And I would guess that, as I mentioned, that even in these smaller countries, given the population and given the number of people who are probably on the internet, then it's very likely that that's close to saturation point. That's close to everybody who could possibly be on this program. I think it's also interesting. Here's Africa, South America. For example, almost 2 million members in Brazil. You get up to North America, you've got about over 1 million in Mexico, another 1,800,000 in Canada. And then in the United States, we have an interesting group. Here in Utah, there's 89,000. Last year, earlier this year, they had the Roots Tech Conference at the Salt Palace in Salt Lake City, and they're now saying it's the largest conference of its kind in the world. And they had about 10,000 people there. Well, what would happen, I always speculate. What happens if all these MyHeritage people all of a sudden decide to go to the conference, 89,000 of them? Let's say next February when they have the conference, all 90,000 of these people show up. I mean, they're all genealogy interested people. Maybe they'll all of a sudden all decide to go to this big conference. Not likely, but anyway. That's sort of interesting how many people there are. And the question, I guess, is who are these people? I mean, they're certainly not people I would come in contact with. When I talked, before this agreement became very well known and the people started joining MyHeritage, I would go into a group of people here in Arizona or here in Utah, 200 or 300 people, and I'd say, how many of you have ever heard of MyHeritage? And you'd get 3 hands in the back. And you'd say, okay, how many of you are on? And you'd maybe get half of that, if there's a possibility. 1.5 people on. That half person was having a lot of trouble. But really, the numbers were just, almost 0. Obviously, there's a little bit more, awareness of the program. But we still have people who are going onto the program, looking at that startup screen and going, what am I supposed to do here? I have no idea what I'm doing on this program. Maybe some of you have come up to that, have that problem. Okay, so now if we get out of all this mapping things, and we get back to the program. Okay, the first thing is that the basis of the program is to have a family tree. Now, all of the other programs that you've worked with online have been what I would call static databases. You go into the program, you put in your names, you search, you try to find the person, you get 50-100 responses and none of them are your guy, and then you search again and you just keep doing that. Okay, very, very common. There's some tricks. Occasionally, you'll hit the jackpot, you'll get a bunch of sources for your person and then you'll just keep searching. So what we've done historically is we have used names as the basis for our search. So we've inherited the names from someone. Someone gave us a GEDCOM and a whole file of information, or we've got a book that we got from our ancestors or some other thing. So whatever we've gotten, oral tradition, they've handed down the names of the ancestors, it's written in the Bible. Whatever it is, we start with a bunch of names. And we have no sources. We have absolutely no idea where these names came from. We don't know if they were made up or if they're real or what. But we go out and start searching for the names. And our ICOM says, if I know the name and I know the place and I know the date, then I go out and I'll search until I find a source. But then what happens when we find the source? We may find out the information that we had was all wrong. I mean, I've had people I've talked to in my brick wall classes, not this last year, the year before, I had a class, maybe it was last year, I don't know, I can't remember years anymore. I had a class at the Mesa Family Search Library. We took a whole month, we had the class every day, five days a week for 4 weeks, and we had people in there, 23 people came consistently for the whole class, and we talked about breaking down brick walls. And almost all of the people in the class found the person that they were looking for. Now, why? Well, because we've been out there looking for names. But I was interesting the kind of reaction I get back from people when this subject comes up, because they'll come up to me and they'll say, Brother Tanner, guess what? And I'll say, I can guess, but go ahead. And they say, Well, you know how we've been looking for my great-great-great-grandfather for the last 30 years, and all these people have looked for them. He said, well, finally we looked at the records and we found out that we've been looking for the person with the wrong name all these years. You know, and the more tragic one is where they come to me and they say, well, you know what happened? And I say, I guess, no, go ahead, tell me again. So they say, well, you know, we've been working on this line, my family and my cousins and everybody have been working on this line now for the last 25 years, and guess what? We found out we're not even related to these people. Okay, so why is that? Why does that occur? Well, what that occurs is because you start with a name without any sources, and then you assume that person is automatically your ancestor. Well, the opposite way of doing this is to start with sources and build your pedigree from sources, so that when you look at a source, it says this is the information that's on the source. And then I hear people say, they sit there and argue with it. They go, well, that's wrong. And I say, so what? It's a source. If you think it's wrong, then we'll go look for more sources. But right now, that's what it says. And that's the best information we have. So it's either your word. I had somebody come in to the library down in Mesa, and I said, and they sat down and he told me this long story about his ancestors and what he was looking for and this person he was looking for, and these are the names and these are the dates and these are the places. And I'm sitting there with my computer and I'm just, my automatic reaction is, okay, well, let's look up this place and see where it is and see if it exists. And he looked at me and he said, are you calling me a liar? I went, I don't think this is going well. Understand that there are no final results in genealogy or history. We're always open to changing anything that has when we find a source. You think, I was born on this date at this time, but I'm telling you, I've sat down with people and I have started to look through the records, and we've had, you know, breakdowns. I've had people dissolve into tears. I've had people go hysterical almost. Because what? They found out that their parents weren't married when they were born. Or they find out that they're not their parents, that they're not adopted, and no one ever told them. Or any number of other things happen. You know, they find out that their great-grandfather, who was not a pillar of the community, was sitting in the federal prison the last time they looked. You know, this is the kinds of things that people find in genealogy, and sometimes they're not all pleasant. But that comes because you're looking at sources and not listening to what the people in the family have said all along. Not that they're wrong, just mostly wrong, sometimes. Okay, so here's what we have. We have a family tree. And when you start putting people in, then you can put in your names and your parents' names, and then you can go over here and keep going. Now you may say, have some questions about this particular type of format for the program. It looks a little bit different than what you're used to, maybe. But let me just say this, if we think of our pedigree charts, the kinds of charts that we have commonly to pass out to people, if you talk to someone who has never had any genealogy, never looked at a genealogy sheet, and you hand them our standard pedigree form, they're going to look at it and go, what is this? What do I do with it? What am I supposed to put on here? Okay, that's the reaction, because this is very foreign. And I've spent, you know, some time trying to explain to people, well, this is you, and this is your parents, and this is your father, and this is your mother, and why is your father on top, and why is the mother down here? I don't know, but anyway, we do it that way. Okay, well, this one, people do understand. They'll understand that these people are married, and that if you follow this line down, you're gonna find their children. It's pretty simple. That's why this is used, because it's more familiar to 72.5 million people than the other one that we use all the time. Now, you can also shrink this down a little bit. I mean, you can just scroll in and out so you can get more of a view here from the program. And then you can see who all these people are. Okay, another thing about this program, let me just zoom in a little bit more here so you can see what's going on. On each of these little boxes here, These guys have little pink and blue rabbit ears. Okay, their little pink and blue rabbit ears are linked